We've come today to Rothamsted to meet two plant pathologists, Dr. Jenkyn and Professor Plumb. So, can you tell us a bit more about John Lawes?
Hello, Wedad. Yes, John Lawes was born in Harpenden 200 years ago this year, in fact. And he was a Victorian entrepreneur who basically started the artificial fertiliser industry.
His father died when he was only 8 years old, and so he inherited the local estate and in due course became Lord of the Manor and was a local benefactor as well as a scientist and an entrepreneur.
As a consequence of his inheritance, he started off with, well, a good start in life. He owned the estate, he was Lord of the Manor, but lacking a father from the age of eight, clearly he had to make his own way. He went to school at Eton, he then went to Oxford, but his mother said when he was 20, you better come back and run the estate because the people who were letting or renting Rothamsted had gone bankrupt. So at the age of 20, he left university. That was the end of his formal education. And virtually everything after that, he was self-taught.
So what was he like at school? I bet he was good at biology.
To be honest, as far as we know, he wasn't interested in very much at all at school. He left some records, which we have in the archive, and he really wasn't a very good student. He wasn't very diligent. He used to enjoy playing tricks on the housekeeper, generating electric shocks. So when she touched the door handle or whatever, she jumped and screamed. He didn't show much interest there, and we suspect he wasn't really very interested in what he was studying at Oxford University. We don't know, but we suspect that he probably was expected to study classics, and that didn't interest him.
And when he did get back home, presumably there was an element of running the estate, but one of the first things that he did was he equipped one of the bedrooms as a chemistry laboratory. So basically he could play around and do what he liked, which didn't go down too well with his mother, and probably neither with the housekeeper either. And eventually his mother got fed up with this and kicked him out and said, look, you know, this is not what this house is for, and made him transfer his activities into a barn on one of the fields on the estate. And that essentially was the beginning of his experimental work. He got married on his birthday, on the 28th of December 1842, and he took his wife on a very romantic honeymoon. He took her on the Thames on a boat, looking for a site for his new factory. And when you think about it, the 28th of December is not really the best time of the year to go around, and basically the Thames at that time was an open sewer, so it can't have been particularly pleasant. And he had two children, Charles, who was born 9 months and one day after he got married, and Caroline, who was born the following year.
But did the general populace of the mid-1800s actually know what a superphosphate was?
That's a very good question, Max. And it's a bit difficult to know for certain, but our suspicion is that farmers knew that bones, specifically, were a very good fertiliser, but they probably didn't know why they were a good fertiliser. The scientific community did, though, know that phosphate was an essential plant nutrient, and that's what John Lawes worked on. And what he did was to make the phosphate that the scientists knew were in bones into a more soluble form so that it was a better fertiliser. And he patented that in that process in 1842, and we actually have a copy of the patent here. And the following year, he established a factory to manufacture what we now call superphosphate fertiliser, either from bones or from mineral phosphates, which you dig out of the ground. And in either case, you treat them with sulfuric acid, as I say, to make this more soluble superphosphate fertiliser.
The fertiliser was so successful that in 10 years' time, the farming community decided to recognise the contribution that John Lawes had made to agriculture by raising a testimonial for him. This got together more than £1,000, and they asked John what he wanted to do with the money, and he said, can you build me a new laboratory? And that was a testimonial laboratory, which you see some of the materials here, the label and the interior.
When John Lawes was developing superphosphates, how did he know that what he was doing was good for plants?
How would you do it? If you were manufacturing something that you wanted to sell, you would set up a demonstration to show how wonderful it was. That, to some extent, is what I believe he set up some of the initial experiments on. The first experiment that he set up was on turnips. Superphosphate is particularly good for turnips.
And also the very famous one on on wheat. It's the Broadbalk classical experiment, very well known throughout the world. Agricultural scientists come here from all over the world to look particularly at the Broadbalk wheat experiment. So by the time he set up these big experiments in 1843, he already had some good idea of how plants responded to both his superphosphate fertiliser, but also nitrogen fertilisers and so on. Because if we look at the treatments that he tested, they were very, very sensible treatments. So he can't have just plucked them out of the air. He must have had a lot of prior knowledge from earlier short-term experiments.
For all his hard work, do you think he deserves more recognition?
He was recognised, clearly, for his contribution to agriculture. He was made a Fellow of the Royal Society, which is the ultimate accolade for any scientist. He was created a baronet, which is one up from a knight, I have to say, in 1882. And he received numerous medals and awards from universities and various other places. Whether he should receive more recognition or not, I don't know. I mean, clearly those of us who spent our lives at Rothamsted would probably consider that perhaps he should. And various efforts have been made in the past. We celebrated our 150th anniversary, and I think an effort was made to get a postage stamp, for example, you know, a distinguished scientist. But clearly he wasn't distinguished enough for the people who make those decisions. A word or two, perhaps, about the what we call the testimonial laboratory. This was the one built with the money raised from the farming community. Is that it was on the site of the main building that you see as you come in now. And if you want to know where exactly it was, the boulder, the big stone in front of it, was positioned exactly in the centre of the testimonial laboratory. That was put up in 1893 to celebrate 50 years of experiments here.
And also I would say, if you look at any history book on agricultural science, Lawes will be there.
So, John Bennet Lawes, 200 years old this month. Thank you very much, Dr. Jenkyn and Professor Plumb.
It's been a great pleasure, and we hope that you might consider coming back at some time in the future.
Yeah, and thank you for coming and showing an interest in Sir John Lawes.